Dear subscribers, as you know, we shared many information for you, and we are studying very hard to find current news for you. However, I cannot use this channel for future. Please follow our new channel called As Daily News Report and watch our video to support us. Link in description. Also, you can reach the video we shared on Daily News Report by clicking on the top right button. We highly recommend watching, subscribing, and sharing. We will continue to share some news on this channel, but we take precautions against some situations for future. Thank you for supporting us.
Welcome to this special presentation, which is a sequel to the video I recently completed and posted on the Gold Money website, entitled Everyone Should Have a Precious Metals Portfolio. That video provides some good background information on where the monetary and financial worlds are headed, and I highly recommend taking the time to view it. This video provides an update to a long-standing forecast I made back in 2003 in Barron's, the sister newspaper of the Wall Street Journal. You may have seen that article or heard me or others talk about it since then because it has received a lot of attention over the years. Recalling that gold was $350 back in 2003 and the Dow Jones Industrials average was about $9,500, I both forecast that gold and the Dow would be $8,000 sometime between 2013 and 2015. Given that this time frame is now upon us, I would like to discuss the basis on which I made that forecast and, more importantly, updated in one significant way. I now expect the price of gold will rise higher than $8,000 per ounce, as I will explain in a minute. But first, I would like to explain the logic behind my original forecast. It begins by considering the business cycle, or what the Austrian School of Economics calls the trade cycle. As its name implies, business activity rises and then falls, only to eventually rise again. This cyclical pattern recurs because of actions taken by banks and governments. Central banks usher in a policy of easy credit to pump up the economy, and as a result of this cheap money, banks lend and lend and lend, while borrowers borrow and borrow and then borrow some more until the banks and the borrowers become overleveraged. This level of debt becomes unsustainable because a lot of debt is used for projects that would never have been even considered if the central banks hadn't induced a boom, like the misallocation of capital that was wasted building houses in Spain and Ireland that should never have been built. Once the bust begins, the total debt is reduced either by borrowers repaying the loans or having them written off by the banks at a loss, which is inevitable for many bad loans. For some banks, the losses may be so large they become bankrupt, which if the bank is large enough can start a panic, as occurred, for example, with the failure of Northern Rock in the UK in 2007. That failure, though, did not have any cross-border impact, in contrast to the failure of Lehman Brothers in 2008, which had a global impact. And as bad as the Lehman failure was, it did not end the financial bust that began 12 years ago, again because of government intervention that stopped the unwinding of debts. So the current bust is ongoing because the level of debt in the banking system has not yet been reduced to manageable and prudent levels. Only then does the bust end. So let's consider, for example, the major business cycles over the last century and where we are in the present cycle, which I will illustrate by showing the primary trends of three different stock markets. First, this chart presents the price of the Dow Jones Industrial Average from 1913 to the present. But let me add two other indices to this chart. These are the FTSE in the UK and Germany's DAX. Although data from 1913 is not available for them, I have included the FTSE and DAX to show that business cycles are a global phenomenon. But note that I am not presenting these charts using gold as the numeraire, or in other words, I am using gold as the common currency to measure the price of each of these stock market indices. So you can see the number of ounces that is the price of these indices on the right-hand scale and gold grams on the left. Beginning in 1913 and following the blue line, which is the Dow Jones Industrials, we can clearly see the boom of the Roaring Twenties, which was followed by the bust of the Great Depression. Then stock prices rose once again during the 1950s and 60s, along with booming business activity, only to be followed by the bust of the 1970s. Then business activity began accelerating again in the early 1980s, leading to the stock market peak in 2000. The subsequent decline in stock prices marked the beginning of the present bust, which clearly began at the start of the new century, not with the collapse of Lehman Brothers in September 2008, as many people believe. Recognizing, as I did, that a bust had already begun when Barron's interviewed me in 2003, I used this chart to forecast how history would repeat. Although this chart shows only month-end prices, in the 1930s, the Dow fell to 35, believe it or not, and gold was also 35. So they were equivalent, meaning that they reached a 1-to-1 ratio. This ratio repeated at the end of the 1970s bust when the Dow was 800 and gold was 800. So in my interview in 2003, I said to Behrens this 1-to-1 ratio would again be reached when the current financial bust ended, which I expected would be in 10 to 12 years from that interview, which of course means 2013 to 2015. We have all heard the adage that there is a time to be in stocks and a time to be in cash. This chart proves the adage to be true, but not when you hold your cash in dollars, euros, pounds, or any other currency. The adage is true when you hold your cash in gold, which is what I have been recommending since founding Gold Money back in 2001, which brings up an interesting question. Will I be recommending using your money, your gold, to go back into the general stock indices when the 1-to-1 ratio is reached in the future? Yes, if you are inclined to invest in stocks, because portfolio management always means shifting from overvalued assets to undervalued ones and vice versa. And gold will probably be overvalued when this ratio hits 1-to-1 again, just as it was overvalued at $35 in 1934 and 800 in 1980. But will that 1-to-1 ratio occur in 2013 to 2015? Possibly, as I will explain in a minute. But first, I need to explain how I forecast the 1-to-1 ratio would be achieved at $8,000 on gold and $8,000 on the Dow. In 2003, it took roughly $10 to purchase what $1 purchased in 1971 because of inflation and dollar debasement over the intervening 32 years. So given that gold was about $350 at the time of my interview, on an inflation-adjusted basis, gold in 2003 was no different than its $35 price in 1971. So my forecast was that gold and the Dow would simply repeat what happened in the 1970s. So in other words, my forecast was that gold would climb from $350 to $8,000, which on an inflation-adjusted basis is no different than what happened in the 1970s when gold climbed from $35 to $800. But I am now thinking that history will not repeat. My expectation is that gold will climb to more than $8,000 per ounce. Here's why. And interestingly, I identified these reasons back in my 2003 Behrens interview. I just didn't realize at the time the extent to which they would negatively impact the purchasing power of the dollar and conversely, positively impact the price of gold. Here's what I told Behrens, and let me quote the first reason. It's important to look at things that impact the dollar because gold will respond to problems or perceived problems with regard to the future of any currency. Comments by various Fed governors talking about creating any amount of dollars necessary to get the economy jump-started is very scary because it suggests they will debase the dollar. It is interesting that here we are 9 years later and the Fed is still talking about jump-starting the economy. They always think they must intervene to do something rather than let market forces take their natural course. This repeated intervention by central planners damages the economy because price signals are distorted, which causes misallocation of that precious and rare resource, capital. These interventions are just one reason why I call central banking the barbarous relic. You can read all of the other reasons in an essay I wrote called The Barbarous Relic, It's Not What You Think, which is available for downloading free from the Gold Money website. But let's turn to the second reason I gave Behrens. Then there are the increasing deficits of the federal government. This point does not need any explanation. Everyone knows that the federal government spending is out of control, meaning that their deficits are also out of control. So here's the third reason. Finally, there is accelerating demand for gold worldwide. People are increasingly recognizing that gold is cheap. Changes occurring in China could be huge for gold. Indeed, worldwide demand for gold is huge and growing, and for good reason. With interest rates in nearly every major currency near or at zero, there is no incentive to hold currencies. More and more people are holding gold and silver for their liquidity needs. And here's where gold really excels. It is, along with silver too, I should add, the best way to save money. Let me give you an example. I remember as a young boy growing up in the States in the 1950s that my parents could drive to the local gas station and fill up the family car with two silver dollars. Today, $2 won't even buy you a gallon of gas, but you can still fill up the family car with the dollar value of the silver in two silver dollars. That is a real life example of how the precious metals preserve purchasing power over long periods of time, and therefore makes clear why they are the best way of saving money in this present environment of zero interest rates. reckless monetary policies, and ongoing currency debasement. So I expect that 5 or 10 years from now, or even months from now, the weight of silver from 2 silver dollars will still fill the family car. But what will the price of silver and gasoline be? What will the price of gold be? Well, these are questions that everyone is always asking and thinking about, but here's a more profound question. Does it really matter what the price of gold or silver will be? Now, I recognize that question may seem odd, but hear me out. If you don't own dollars or pounds or euros and only own gold and silver for your money needs, you know that your gold and silver will buy you in the future what they buy you today, because if the price of gold and silver rise, the price of gasoline and other commodities will rise along with it because of inflation. Some say that the gold price rises and falls, but we have to reorient our thinking. It is the purchasing power of national currencies that rise and fall. And here's a good analogy to make this point clear. When standing in a boat and looking at the shore, it is the boat, the national currencies, and not the land, gold, that is bobbing up and down. So look at the world from solid land, not the boat, because worryingly, no one knows what the ever-changing purchasing power of dollars or euros or any other currency will buy in the future for two reasons. First, and the more obvious point, is that central banks and governments are destroying the purchasing power of currencies by following bad policies. So we just don't know how much worse inflation and debasement will become in the future. Second, all currencies have counterparty risk, meaning that there is always the risk that your bank could be the next Lehman or Northern Rock. And don't be misled into thinking that governments or their so-called insurance schemes will always make good to you if your bank fails. As we learned not too long ago from the collapse in Iceland or more recently in Greece, governments themselves are your ultimate counterparty risk when you hold the paper money they issue. Importantly, you don't have this worry with gold because it is a tangible asset. Gold has a 5,000-year history as money, so it will not go to zero like Lehman did or like the countless national currencies throughout monetary history whose purchasing power has gone to zero when governments didn't keep their promises. So government counterparty risk can be a real threat to anyone's wealth, and here's the key point. Government counterparty risk has never before been this high. Look, for example, at how many countries have lost their AAA credit rating, including even the United States, which will probably again be downgraded soon given its soaring level of debt. Countries around the globe have made too many promises that they cannot possibly fulfill. Consequently, it is inevitable that many promises made by governments will be broken, so make sure that doesn't happen to you. Hold physical gold and silver for your liquidity needs and minimize the amount of national currency you hold. I recommend doing what I do. Take the money you save each month and buy physical gold or silver. Anyway, let me get back to the point of this video and explain why the price of gold is headed much higher. And I'll do this with the gold money index as illustrated in the following chart. I explained this chart in the video on the gold money site I mentioned earlier entitled Everyone Should Have a Precious Metals Portfolio. So I'm not going to get into the detail again, except to say that the fair value for gold today is about $11,000 per ounce. And given that central banks have less gold in their vault than they report, which is the denominator in the equation, and more dollars are being created all the time, the numerator of the equation, simple math illustrates that gold in time will probably exceed $11,000. And that conclusion is confirmed by the next chart, which indicates that the gold price is ready to soar in terms of all the major currencies. Indeed, the gold price on this long-term chart is already accelerating higher. This is a base 100 chart, so I assume that the price of gold in each of these four currencies was 100 on January 1st, 2000. Note too that it is a log scale chart, so we can easily see when the price of gold doubles. In other words, the distance between 100 and 200 on the chart is the same as the distance between 300 and 600. But look at the parabola, the black arrow. It shows that the price of gold is accelerating, and here's the important point. Acceleration like this on a log scale chart is exactly what you expect to see as a currency moves toward hyperinflation. And here we have four major currencies indicating precisely that. This chart gives us a picture showing how the mountain of government debt will be repaid. It will be hyperinflated away. Politicians always take the soft political option. Cutting back spending and putting one's financial house in order is never the soft political option when governments have the ability to keep printing money. When the formal link to gold was broken in 1971, the discipline was removed from the monetary system worldwide. And the consequences of that decision are obvious. Too much debt, too much government spending, too many global imbalances, and as a result of all of these factors, too much worried money sloshing around the globe looking for a home. But here's a key point. Much of this money will eventually end up in physical gold and physical silver as these bull markets progress. Even though we cannot predict the future, we know this outcome to be the case from monetary history. We also know from the gold money index that gold is money that is undervalued compared to the money substitutes called dollars, euros, pounds, francs, and all the rest. We also know that governments cannot print gold or create it out of thin air. And lastly, we know that physical gold is a tangible asset, so it and physical silver too do not have counterparty risk, which makes them the ultimate safe haven. But there's one last point that needs attention. Will it all happen sometime between 2013 and 2015? Unfortunately, no one knows because we cannot predict the timing of when events will unfold. The fiat currency bubble could pop anytime, given the fragility of the world's monetary system as a result of the ongoing interrelated bank solvency and sovereign debt crises. Then again, maybe the proverbial can will be kicked down the road longer than I expect. But I still think that 2013 to 2015 is the time frame when fiat currencies will blow up. Only time will tell, of course, but owning physical gold and silver is the best way to protect you and your family to get through what I expect will be some tough times for the next few years. In this regard, I expect that the collapse of Lehman Brothers was simply a warm-up for what lies ahead. I will conclude by simply emphasizing that if you want the safety and security of professional storage for your precious metals, we at Gold Money can help make that storage convenient for you. And I'm particularly pleased to announce that Gold Money now offers storage in Singapore. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you.
From the 11th of December, Gold Money is offering gold and silver storage in Singapore. To celebrate